Well, the very same question goes, of course, to Sam Peltzman. What sense do you make of what's happened to us and why, and is there a way out?
I said, as I said before the break, it's very complicated and can't be reduced to one line. If I were writing a book, I would title it a Failure of Government Regulation, and it would be probably a more accurate portrayal of the forces that contributed to this decline.
By the way, would you use the word depression in the title of the book if you wrote it?
No, if you're thinking of depression, the Great Depression was a decline in national product of one-third.
Mm-hmm.
We're down 6% now.
So you're saying there's been only one depression in history?
No, but I'd say somewhere between where we are now and a third would qualify for a depression.
Now you're looking at just one thing. You should be looking at the total consequences, and the total consequences of this depression are tremendous, and you're seeing them unfolding.
I have no doubt about that. And this is semantics. What you call right, we're in a very difficult time, and it's not going to be it's not over yet. And we can discuss that.
Discuss it. What's keeping us in the?
You want me to go through some of the causes? Didn't you?
All right. I'll defer that question until later. I want to get out of this mess as quickly as we can.
Well,
that's why I'm eager to put that question.
I appreciate your impatience, but it is complicated.
I'm not impatient with you, but I'm impatient.
I do agree. Please. I do agree that one element, not the crucial, this is the kind of thing where if not for this, it would have been less severe. If not for that, it would have been less severe. Well, the monetary policy of the early 2000s clearly contributed by negative real interest rates. But there's a lot more. We had a social policy to increase owner-occupied housing focused on what? On leverage. You didn't get a credit for being in a house. You got a tax deduction for interest paid on a mortgage. So then we had another social policy to push mortgages down to people who had less creditworthy histories. That contributed. Right? So one could go on. There was a massive regulatory failure in the early 2000s. Dick talked about the deregulation of banking. Banking hasn't been deregulated. Some aspects of banking were deregulated. Those that Dick mentioned are absolutely irrelevant to what's going on now. Other aspects of bank regulation have, in fact, been increased over time. They're not just eddies, as he described. There were two very important upward ratchets in bank regulation focused on the safety side. What Dick was talking about was making loans and securing deposits, the ordinary everyday business of banking. That indeed has been deregulated.
Are you suggesting we were overregulated or underregulated?
I am suggesting that's a very, very good question to which there is no one answer. On the ordinary deposit taking, loan making side of the world, we were overregulated. Now, the deregulation was forced by the market. What Dick did not mention is that those maximum interest rates almost ruined the banking industry. They couldn't get deposits because they were going offshore. The Eurodollar market was created precisely to evade those restrictions. So they were obsolete. They had to go. On the other side, banks, as Dick pointed out, because we insure their deposits and for other reasons, we give them access to the loan window at the Federal Reserve, are regulated in terms of their balance sheet. That aspect of regulation has gone up, not down. It's not been deregulated, and it's failed. And as acknowledged by the last, by Ben Bernanke's predecessor, he acknowledged that it was a failure. I do not think that we're going to. I do not favor deregulation of the asset side of the banking system. If you have deposit insurance, if you have that government intervention, you got to have regulation of the balance sheet.
As I've been reading Richard Posner's book, A Failure of Capitalism, and I do note the important article. It's a failure, not the failure. But beyond that, as I've been reading it, something came to me at some point. You remember the famous story which starts the whole genre of shaggy dog stories? A man advertises for a shaggy dog. People keep coming and bring them to him. It's in London, of course. And he says, no, that's not shaggy enough, not shaggy enough. Finally, a man shows up with a great big shaggy dog, and his response is, oh, that's too shaggy. And my sense is that what you're saying is, though you come from a tradition at the University of Chicago, the law and economics tradition, the rational choice tradition, which argues essentially for free markets rather than controlled and regulated markets, I think what you're saying is, just like not that shaggy, not that free. It's been
too
free.
You can't have free banking markets. Banking is too risky. And I think you have to make two distinctions. One is between the regulatory regime and the administration of the regime. So you can have a regulatory regime that has restrictions, but if it's enforced laxly, it's ineffectual. The other is that what happens, deregulation really proceeds in two stages. The first is you let non-regulated firms offer close substitutes for the regulated, like checkable money market accounts. Then that, of course, puts great pressure on the regulated firms to be allowed to pay interest on their deposits. So the regulatory system unravels as you have non-regulated firms offering substitute services. What to do about that? I mean, Sam is right. There's a big loss if you try to pen these things in. It may be infeasible. But I don't think there's also a question, what do you take as something that could be changed, and what do you think is part of the immovable background? So the tax deduction for mortgage interest, that's a mistake. And that certainly does lead to overinvestment in homes.
A way around that would be to give up income tax and just do the flat tax instead.
Well, no, you can have the income tax. No reason to allow. A lot of people can't deduct their ordinary interest. Why should they be allowed to deduct mortgage interest and home equity? It doesn't make any sense. But that's probably immovable part of it. So the regulatory system has to take account of the fact that there's certain things that are risk-creating, like the tax deduction, or like the fact that, it's cheaper to borrow capital than to raise it by selling equity.
The tax deduction lures people into home purchase.
Borrowing. Yeah. So, but I'd say pardon?
That wasn't my point. Once the banking industry responds to the incentives that it has to take risks, incentives that are created by government policy, deposit insurance being the prime example, once it responds to those, the fact that you have a mortgage the fact that housing policy is fixated on leverage becomes dangerous. We have Fannie and Freddie. We haven't talked about them. The biggest failures of the last couple of years were another manifestation of this fixation on leverage. Leverage is fine. So are default swaps and everything else we're going to talk about. They're fine in their place, but you have to put them in a context, and the context is one that led to massive problems.